It's an amazing crowd we have here tonight. We've got, which includes three generations of my family. There's old friends, new friends. We've got some old headers here. We've got some young people, a couple of top-notch photographers that are nationally known that are here. And it's the old headers are the ones that scare me because they know too much. And I got to be so careful with my dates and locations and names. And I got to be careful not to call Old Town, because I'll never hear the end of it. But my family always called it Old Town. Everybody knew what we were talking about. So we have the old townhouse and old Burial Hill and the old post office and the old townies. So it's Old Town. But a couple of people that are no longer with us that it would have been nice to have here tonight is my father, Vincent Dixey. He was always the first one I'd call when I found new pictures and would spend a couple hours looking at them together. The other, as Jack mentioned earlier, was Bob Osborne. And he was a huge, huge, huge influence on my interest in the old Marblehead pictures. I had the pleasure of going to a couple of his slideshows, and you know, as you see the now and then with these old photos, the same thing, the way the slideshows have progressed. He did them with a slide projector and slides in these slots, and he had a stick instead of instead of a laser pointer. He's using a stick to point things out. So we've come a long way from that. But I did one of these here for the 350th. It was more of an exhibit with the photos set up, and I did a small presentation. And it was, Bud Orne was here. We got Snow and Orne and Woodfin. We got Dolliver, Peach, and Dixie. So a lot of names you'll see in the Marblehead history books. Now, when I started collecting, well over 30 years ago, we moved up to Kenneth Road, and I really knew very little about Marblehead history or my family tree, and I started getting interested in it. So I started doing the research. We were living right at the end of Kenneth Road. We had Gordon Peach lived across the street. There were Dolliver's living up the end of the road. And so I started doing I started working on the family tree, and then that's what got me into to the old photos. But when I did the family tree, it turned out the location, this is a map from the year 1700, and this is actually second generations of the families here, but you can see my window was overlooking the ferry, which my ninth great-grandfather, Thomas Dixey, rode back and forth from Marblehead to Salem, starting in 1644. And you can see, and his neighbors were Peaches and Dolliver's. And it's like, you know, well over 300 years later, and some things hadn't changed. But this is my mother and father. That's at my grandparents' house, which is up on 14 Nicholson Hill. When they bought the house, it still had an outhouse. They didn't put actually plumbing in a bathroom until the 1950s. And that's my father. He worked for the village rug for many years. That photo was taken in 1953, based on the calendar on the wall. Now, going through the old pictures, my family pictures, I found a theme of guitars, and that's my youngest brother, Barry, who's obviously left-handed and has a guitar upside down, but he was a Marblehead fire chief for 10 years. In the 1960s, there was a very popular local rock group, Jack and the Spades, and three of the kids were from Marblehead. There was Eddie Waliakis, Doug Hill, and then my oldest brother, Mike Dixie. And they played lots of dances at the YMCA. They played at the Warwick Theater. They even played the New York World's Fair in 1964. Then Mike's son, Brian, he's sitting next to me. He's our sound man today and is responsible for getting all this equipment in here. That's my daughter, Amanda. Some of you might know her from the National Grand Bank. And there's a newspaper clipping from 1967. Some of my Star of the Sea classmates, I was a big guy back then. And I still have that guitar, the silver tone, probably has the same strings on it. But at Star of the Sea, the nuns took us to a couple of nursing homes to play Christmas carols. They didn't put the picture in the paper until May. It must have been a busy news year. And this is, that's my other daughter, Melissa. She's a tutor at the Glover School. She doesn't really play guitar, but I told her to pose in front of her fiancé's guitar so she wouldn't feel left out. And then this one is my, that's my grandson, Wyatt. This picture was taken 5 years ago. He's got his little guitar. He's 8 years old now. He's actually here tonight, and he's one of his favorite buildings to see is Abbot Hall. He loves the Lee Mansion. He loves Marblehead history. So yeah, don't be surprised if sometime in the future he's not up here doing the presentation and talking about his 11th great-grandfather, Thomas Dixey, that ran the ferry. Oh, and he scored 3 touchdowns in his football game last Saturday. Now, with my collection, as it pertains to all of my collection at Marblehead, the format of the films are just a couple of things to point out as they relate to the image you'll see tonight. That's a slide, which is 35 millimeter, and that was a popular film size before digital came out. And you can see the size of the film that captured the images. Next to it is a glass negative. I have close to 1,000 of them that size, which is 6.5 by 8.5. And you can see the surface area that the lens had to put the image on. And you can get quite a bit of detail. That's an 11 by 14. I have about 20 of those. And it's just the detail you can get. So when you see the pictures, some of the newer ones that were from slides or newer photos aren't as sharp and as clear as the ones I have. My glass negatives go from 1898 into the 1920s, and those are much sharper images because of those were taken by Fred Lichman, who was a professional photographer. So so amazing quality. The other thing, the film speeds were much slower back then. So when you see old pictures, they had to pretty much stage the setup. At the time of these negatives, the exposures were probably only several seconds long. Before that, some people would have to sit for an hour to have a portrait taken. So you'll see very serious faces when portraits are done. Photographers actually used to have a neck brace that they'd have them so they could sit still for that long while the lens was open. What happens on some of the street scenes, they'll have people that stay still for the picture, but if anybody's moving, they become blurry and almost look like ghost images. And I'll point out a few of those in the collection. And then of course today we use SD cards, and I can probably fit my collection of well over 3,000 images on one of those cards today. So I'll start out, the first 6 to 7 images are from old cabinet cards, so they're a little bit faded and not as clear as the glass negatives, but I kind of did group these by parades and celebrations. Now this is 1884, and this is coming into town. It's Pleasant Street, and looking down the Village Plaza, we'd be down on the left at the bottom of the hill. So Village Street and Cross Street would be about the back where the photographer was standing. And you can see they put up this big archway. It says welcome. And you never see these in any other photos, so we assume they were just put up all over town just for this one big parade celebration they had that year. You can see the trolley tracks coming in from Salem. And this is the Mugford building that same year. You can see how they went all out with the decorations. They really decorated well. The Mugford building was actually only 4 years old when this photo was taken. You can see a couple of blurry images there where people were walking down the sidewalk. And the old townhouse that same year, decorations all over it. Several ghost images were, people running down the street. This might have even been a horse and carriage coming down, a blurry flag that was up over the photographer's head. And that was just one of the floats that the Gary School, it said Gary Girls Grammar School, and it's all girls in these pictures. This is one of the patriotic groups, and their costumes. I think that's in front of the old Marblehead Academy up on Pleasant Street, the brick building now. It used to be a wooden structure. Now this one's got a lot in it. This is Pleasant Street looking, well, the Rockabye building is here. So the Spirit of 76 bookstore is in that corner now. So School Street cuts across here. And again, they had one of these arches. They put up decorations all over the buildings. Here's a couple of women that were moving with their big long white dresses, moving down the street while the shutter was open. And this is down by the Franklin Street fire station. They put up another one of those arches. This may have been all the firefighters in the town at that time. I noticed, I think all the windows are open, they don't look like they use screens. And this is 10 years before electricity was run, where electric light was in town, so they didn't have electricity in the houses during this. Now this is 1899, this is a glass negative. And this was a parade for the Spanish-American War of 1898. They had a parade for the soldiers. And this is the three of the Marblehead policemen. This is on Pleasant Street in Washington. The three cod is over on the side here now. You can see Abbot Hall in the background. And then here's another shot with the cannon and some of the soldiers in the wagon behind it. This is actually a Woodfin brothers wagon that they use. And what I like about this one is the photographer up on the roof there with his big box camera. And that's the kind of camera that was used for these big glass negatives. The photographer that took this picture was probably on the roof of Hutchie's Chips, which when they opened in 1890, so it would have been there, and that's about the angle of it. In 1903, this is down by, that's Rogers Market, right up by the townhouse. I think it's the bus stop now. I'm not good at what's in these locations now, so forgive me. And there's another float, Liberty. The one before it said Daughters of Liberty, so they had these Liberty groups, and there's that Rogers Market again. I guess it was Moxie season. And this is in Bank Square. At the bottom of the hill down here, where Hooper Street comes in, there's a nice bike shop there, and looks like another happy group to be in the parade. But they're all dirt roads. It was probably dusty, and if you take a look at those wheels, and I don't see any springs and no suspension, so riding around town on that thing probably wasn't all that much of a thrill. And you can see some kid ran by there. You can see some legs here where somebody was standing before he took off. And that's the greater block. It's the same year, 1903. You can see all the decorations. And the fancy top, the next slide, you can see the top a little bit better, but that's what the top on that building was originally built. And this was the decorations. This was after World War I. They got the welcome home sign on the side of the building. And this was called Cook's Corner. That's Pleasant Street coming down. The photographer was standing on Washington Street looking back that way. And you got the A&P grocery store, Atlantic and Pacific there. And Cook's Jewelers was on the corner. And that's where the toy store is now. And this one was up on Pond Street. I think they had a lot of like neighborhood parades up there. And I guess they put up this whole archway just for the parade. They have the names. It was one in the black coat is Emily Stone. You got Carolyn Peach Burns next to her. Bessie Peach Letourneau is the baby in the carriage. And they got Ruth and Alice Knight. And that's 1914. Then this was the Burgess Parade. During the war, the Burgess plant was making airplanes. And so this was the float for the cable wire department. And I think they're in the back showing what they used. This was around 1918. And this is up on Elm Street, and it's Story Terrace going up there. I think this house kind of looks the same there. And this was the same parade as the wing workers. I think they were demonstrating how they assembled the wings. And these guys in the back, I originally thought that they had these planes on sticks, but those are actually hats that they made that had the wings on them, and they wore those in the parade. I love seeing the way they dressed, the little kids. Everybody got dressed up back then. They'd wear jackets. Everybody had a hat on. Looks like they're following the parade, and, you know, keeping his sister's hand so she doesn't get lost. But then this is down. Lichman's is still in that building, the Lee Mansion's over here. Looks like they were getting ready for a parade that day. There's a couple of the policemen walking down the sidewalk, the little boy walking next to him. He's got little boys all dressed up with this tie and a hat on, and you can see they all dressed up. And most of the boys were wearing knickers back then, too. This one's undated, but it's down kind of in front of the apartment building now, down on Front Street, Fort Sewell's up that way. And it looks like maybe some old veterans doing a little parade. I love the crank on the front of the old car they used to start them. Then this one is, I think this is on Pleasant Street, and it's the Civil War veterans in the parade. That was next to the Warwick Theater. One of these was Kalo, William Kalo, who was a barber in town. Looks like some kind of clothing store that was there, and it was, you know, it was decorated for the parade in 1919. There's the soldiers after the war. Got the Army soldiers here, the Navy in behind them. And so they must have given them like carnations before it, so every one of them has a flower in their hand. You can see a couple of them are smelling the flowers as they walk. People watch the parade looking out their windows. This is right outside, a little ceremony they had outside the townhouse. There was two drugstores side by side, actually. There was two hardware stores side by side at one time down there, too. I think that's the First National Stores grocery store on the corner. That's State Street, the corner of State Street. That's the American Legion band outside was the new post office. It's condos or something now. And it's got number 60 Pleasant Street there, and the Masonic Temple building. 1929, they had a parade, and this was the 300th anniversary, which is the 300th anniversary of the settling of the town, and then they did the 300th celebrations of the town's incorporation, which would have been in 1949. And this is outside of Abbot Hall, right down the back of the square. This is on Elm Street. This is 119 Elm Street. It looks like I went by there today, and it looks the same. It's still got that little stonework under there. And you know, you had the military groups. And this one, all the kids dressed up, and the boys dressed up in uniforms for different wars. They carried a sign of the year. So they had 1861, it was a Civil War. The boys dressed up Civil War. The girls dressed up in period costumes. And they had 1898 for the Spanish-American War, 1917 for World War I. And this one, the Spirit of 76, they had the three of them dressed up leading that group. These kids had little sailboats they made that they had to, I guess, step in and kind of warm around their waist as they marched to represent the Navy. And it's just a group either probably before or after the parade. Again, that's right in front of 8 Washington Square, right outside the building here. And the baby carriages in that parade. They used to have parades around town that the little girls would take their doll carriages and their dolls and then decorate them all up, and then they'd get all dressed up and they'd have their little parades. I couldn't read what the signs said on the front of some of these carriages. And this is on Atlantic Avenue. I usually find more interesting the stuff in the background of these pictures than the actual parade that they were taking pictures of, because of the businesses and what's around. There was Woodford Express was down in the corner. I can make out the sign when I zoom in on it. But you had several gas stations. You had Mayflower gasoline here. This is Gulf gasoline. And it actually looks like there might have been gas pumps there. We can check with Bill Conley later and see. He knows where all the gas stations were. And there's a Lifesaver truck. Saw that. It's kind of neat. And I don't know if I said this is Atlantic Avenue looking down. The bank is on the corner here now, and Shoes is over in that corner. That's Roundy's Hill up there. Then there's another patriotic float, and that's right outside the townhouse, that William Lemon drugstore that we saw earlier, the brick building. And they had these stars with names on them, and that one, it's Evans and Brown. They were they both died during the war over in France, and I think Evans was he was supposed to take out a German machine gun nest in France, and he got shot and killed during that. And Brown actually caught pneumonia and died over in France. He was 23 at the time. And this is the old Stevens Shoe Factory at 14 Atlantic Avenue. I think somebody's down around the corner, all its decorations. Then you've got the Gregory block with the decorations. Tony's Pizza's in there now. And of course, this was before the fire that that we had in recently, or well, 20 years ago maybe. And again, all decorated. This one I just found the other day and added it because it was a good one of the police, but I don't know the names. I didn't have a chance to see who the 1937 who the policemen were, but it's a good shot of the five or six of them. Now this is from a color slide, 1944, and it's on Pleasant Street. You can see the Baptist Church down there, kind of taken in front of the Marblehead Academy building with a red cross group. Great colors too for early slide film. A lot of the slides they have are all faded or they have a color cast to them, but these were very sharp. There's the Brownies in that same parade, 1944. So I don't know, maybe some of these girls are here tonight watching. I don't know the names of them, but. And there's the Legion Post 32 and the crew of the USS Marblehead marching behind them. You can see in 1944 the kind of the clothing that people were wearing. Now these aren't dated, but I'm guessing these might be late 40s. This was a muster parade. I think this was a hand tug from out of town, but down in front of Shoes, which on Atlantic Avenue where CVS is now, that's where Shoes started their market. They had the market here and a liquor store on the right. I love the old cars in these pictures too. And there's the Gary 5. They've got the pumper behind it, a little cannon mounted on top of the car. Looks like a PT Cruiser. And somebody told me that Sylvia and Bill Shube are standing in the doorway there. This was the liquor store side. You can see all the fresh fruits and vegetables in the grocery store. There was a door inside that you could go in between the two stores. Then this one, I'm not sure. These two guys look like they noticed the liquor store, and I'm thinking about that. I think this was before scary clowns were around, so they hired this guy to terrorize people. Just another shot of another group. I love the colors on this one too. These were great. And then there's a wide shot from the same day. They must have started the parade right along here. It looks like they were all starting to pull out to start. You can see them lined up all the way back to Seaside. This gas station, the good one, like the old gas pumps, I'm not sure who was running it at this time, but Bruce Swayze had his place in there. He used to deliver oil around town. He was in there for a number of years. The sign over here says Upton Insurance Agency and said real estate underneath it. It's just down at the Memorial Park, a celebration in 1945. That's Essex Street and behind there. This picture, I brought this one to, we have these meetings up in Maine. A bunch of Marbleheads get together up there. Some are from Maine now, some in New Hampshire. There's a few from Marblehead. Bill Conley was at the last one. I brought a few pictures that I was actually trying to find out the location of this because it was marked Elm Street and I couldn't place this house. And I showed it to Bill. He goes, well, I can tell you that's my father on the right-hand side. So that's William H. Conley. And he said that this is Ed Farrell on the side here. In 1951, I guess the Gary was the league champions that year, so we had a little victory parade around town. This is State Street. This is outside the townhouse because the hardware store was still in that location at the time. And the Horribles Parade, 1952. Oh, Rick, I found a couple of photos after you asked me. The sign to hit the registration over there, and this is the same day, and this is again where Tony's Pizza which I should be getting free pizza for the amount of times I mentioned Tony's in my presentations. But that was Unity Service in there. You can see it was the hardware store, which was Murphy's Hardware, then it was later Rogers Hardware, and now it's the Atomic Cafe is in there. You can see the Rockabye building in the background. Then this is 1953 down on Atlantic Avenue, around the corner, kind of in front of the bank, and there's one of the Gulf station that was later run by Charlie Lee, had his station in there. The next slide is the other side of the street. You can see two more gas stations. You have the Texaco in that corner. There was this Esso gas station, that's the lot where Mino's is in the back of now. That was in there. You can see Eaton's drugstore. And in between this corner where the bank was and the gas station was Damon Tucker's, which was a very, very popular store. Been trying for years to find a good picture of Damon Tucker's and haven't come up with one yet. Actually, Damon Tucker's daughter, she lives up in Maine, and she comes to those get-togethers we have every couple of months to talk about Marblehead stuff. And this is 1956, again on Washington Street, down by the townhouse, and there was another muster parade. This is the Gary group. There's just some of the fire trucks. This photo is probably taken from the townhouse, maybe from the window up high down the street. And there was Harris, some of these signs were Harris's Luncheonette, Cameron's Pastry, and then there was the little shoe repair place was Mormino's place, and then his son Peter had the sandwich shop in that same location for a number of years. I think he shut down that maybe 10 years ago. And there's some of the police and that parade. Joe Cuff is over here, and Captain John Wheeler in the front. And I think that's one of the Browns. I couldn't identify this officer. Looks like a Dalmatian over here, probably looking for the fire department. That's just a couple of kids up. This was in October, so I don't know if there was a parade that day. They had their flag. I love the shoes that they were wearing. Actually, I was about this age in 1958, but I don't recognize who those kids are. But it was back when you could open carry without a special permit. Then 1958, this is where the Landing restaurant is now. This is Front Street. You've got the parking lot off to the side, and another Spirit of 76 group. And here they're coming up State Street. There was a liquor store on the corner where it's like an art studio now. You can see the harbor in behind it and the parking lot. The parking lot was actually much smaller than it is now. They filled in an inside section. I think I have some photos of that in later slides. And that's the wagon train, and that was Ed Shin, who owned the Village Rug, always had horses and ponies in town, and his son Ned. I think that might be Ned, I'm not sure. It looks like him. And you can see that liquor store in the background, the antique store on the corner. That's State Street, and this is Front Street again. And that was the Defiance from Rhode Island. This was another muster parade, so they didn't come all the way from Rhode Island just to be in a parade. They were up for a muster, and they paraded around town. That was just the all girls drumming bugle corps out of Salem. This group was from Wakefield, the Wakefield Redmen, I guess when it was politically correct to dress up like Indians and nobody was insulted or something. I think that's Elizabeth Warren. This is down in front of what used to be the high school on Pleasant Street. I don't think that was one of the Marblehead trucks. I think that says Marblehead. I don't know if there was really a parade down here or they were just heading back out of town after one. And in 1964, for the Horribles Parade, these kids were protesting the Mary Alley Hospital was going to be closing. They were taking the maternity ward out of there, and there was going to be nobody else born in Marblehead. So that's what this float represents. And then it says, "Us Marbleheaders would rather fight than switch." And that was there was a popular cigarette commercial back when you could have those on TV that used that slogan, and they had a black eye. So they kind of used that slogan for, you know, their protest of the closing of the hospital. Then this is this is 1965. This is on Green Street, and this is, I don't know if that's Powderhouse Court or Green Street Court. You can see in the background the Association Building. There used to be actually two of them in that location, side by side. It's just houses now. And that's Don Bartlett leading this group. This is the Yoko's group. It's Ricky and Gary Bartlett's father, Don, and Jim Laramie is in the middle, and Tom Rhodes is on the left, and Jackie Woods on the right. And the two kids are the Jackman kids. Now, I think this was the same day. The photographer must have run ahead of the parade to catch him down, kind of in front of the National Grand Bank now. And this is where Starbucks is today. It used to be Miller Ford. Nice painting of the harbor on the side of the building. And I think they had the showroom for new cars in here, and then the repair grade bays were in the back. And you can see Brown's florist. Norman Brown ran that. And he comes to those meetings we have in Maine as well. This one I always thought was kind of a neat picture. It's not real sharply focused, but just the cars in 1965, the bicycles, the way kids dressed up to go to parades. You know, these girls in their dresses, and you know, these in their little uniforms for the parade. You got the ice cream truck, this girl eating the ice cream. And I posted this on Facebook, I don't know, maybe 6 months ago, and someone says, "Hey, that's me and my brother in the carriage." It's Cindy and Rick Doan, and that's Leanne Clark, I think Peter Clark's daughter, on the pole there. Now there's another Oakles group, and we got Gary Bartlett, Kip Dolliver, that might be Tommy Tucker, and that's Ricky Bartlett. And 50 years later, they're still very involved in the Okos. I think that's on Turner Road, probably heading up towards the cemetery. Was it, Rick? Do you remember? Is that where you were?
I have no idea. I look like
now this parade, probably another muster parade. That's an out of town. But this is down. This is School Street and Pleasant Street. This is just part of the corner where the National Grand Bank parking lot is, but there was the Nelson Company, and then Mason's 5 and 10 was there afterwards. You can see that's where the Spirit of 76 bookstore is. They used to have this little bulletin board with glass doors that they put stuff in. That's just another shot of the same parade. Probably, this is where we used to watch it. At the time, I was living up on Reed Street, and this is where we used to walk down and watch the parade, so I don't know, I could be in there someplace watching this. This was on Darling Street in 1958. I'm not sure the different parade routes they had around town. And I was kind of looking, thought there was some kind of military. I was trying to figure out this flag, and I was online searching. I think it's a Girl Scout flag. So. Then here's 1968, another horrible parade, just a bunch of kids dressed up like the historic buildings. You got Abbot Hall just cut off over here, and the various at Herreshoff Castle. I like the old powder house. They use an umbrella for the rounded roof. This was 1968. It was Smokey Joe's banjo band, and they always get good crowds for the concerts up at Crocker Park. Now this one, that's 1970, that's up by Village Street on Pleasant. This is Cross Street. And it shows another one of the gas stations, the Getty Station. There was actually a gas station here, and then across the street over here, Armin Barasa had a gas station as well. And this, Ed Courtney was running this one. If I zoom in on this slide, I can see the gas pumps. It was 35 cents a gallon. And that's actually Karen Cloutman and her grandmother. I went to school with Karen, standing in the crosswalk there watching the parade. This is just up at Crocker Park, the Glover's Regiment salute, 1976. And 1979, 350th celebration. Again, the 350th of the settling of the town, we did in, one for the incorporation later on. And this is just the same place where the gas station was before. You can see some of the businesses that were there in 1979. And this says it's the Marblehead's oldest citizens. It was Maud Emery and Oliver Killam. I don't know. I think old Maud looks kind of bored. I think she's playing Candy Crush on her phone. 1990, the police. We had Dave Millett, Donnie Decker. We got John Blaisdell. Nick Economo that I went to school with, and Paul Bellier. And I actually think in the fire thing, it might be Gary Bartlett in the back, because those Bartletts love parades. These are just some various events and places around town. It was 1959, the Hunt's Circus came to town. This is over at Riverhead, the parking lot at Riverhead Beach. These aren't just any elephants, these are television elephants. Whatever the hell that is. Now this is 1973. At the time, we were living on Reed Street, which is in the background. This is looking from Village Street, looking behind Gilbert and Cole. There's just some little fire back there. And Bessem Street runs in through here. And the next one you can see, this is where Heritage Way runs now. Comes right through here. The old railroad tracks were here. McGuire had a little repair shop out of there and that silver trailer. You can see there was a car wash laundromat on Bessem Street that John Proctor had built. We watched him build that. I think, I don't remember if that was before or after they started with the Village Plazas down there. This was just up on Naugus Head's a celebration of the Improved Order of Redmen, and they have their annual picnics. And this is from a glass negative, and if I zoom in on it, I can read the writing on some of these boxes. The tables had names on them, and it was a very clear image. Now that was down on Orange Street, 1951, little gas explosion in the house. The woman was okay. They took her to the Mary Alley Hospital, which of course was right around the corner at the time, down on Franklin Street. And I don't think the realtors use this photo in there when they try to sell the house. Sorry, Jack. In the 1968, when the lead mill, the big fire down at the, coming into town, like the entering Marblehead signs right about here, the big yellow building that was there for years, was a huge fire. We actually went over to Loring Avenue and watched it across the water. I don't know how everybody found out about it. You didn't have cell phones, you didn't have texting, but everybody in town knew about that fire and was down watching it. And just some model sailboats up at Red's Pond. I guess not too much has changed there, maybe some more trees. And there's this one's undated, it's just a little bit later version of the sailboats that they used. And this one, 1965. You see everybody's got the long sticks they use to push them off. I don't know if they're all remote controlled now or not. And then this barn over here was the barn that same year that Link Hawks was to move. And I heard his original plan was to drag it across the ice when the ice was frozen, and he kind of thought better of that. So he floated it across to the other side, which is where it still is, with a Link Hawks special moving device. It just looks like a bunch of pallets all stacked on top of each other, and it worked, and it got it there. And I'm sure he had all the necessary permits. Now, in 1962, there was the miniature golf next to the laundry up on Lincoln Avenue. And there's a couple of the holes you can see. It was Abbot Hall. The one in the background looks like an old wooden lobster trap that was the obstacle in that hole. And the finish line of the Great Race in 1975. I was actually there. I took this picture, and it was They did that for a number of years. I guess it was to see if you could get from Watertown to Marblehead faster by land or by sea. And they had lots of kegs of beer and open drinking. And so somebody spoiled all the fun, thought that might not be a good idea on town property. So they kind of ended that years ago. That's my t-shirt from 1978. And no, it doesn't fit anymore. And there were some, over the years, there's been different celebrities in town. This one's Mary Pickford. This is 1916. There was an old movie, Pride of the Klan, and they were filming over Marblehead Neck. And ironically, the movie was about an island off of the coast of Scotland. So they built a little village that looked like, you know, a Scottish village, and they did some of the scenes there, probably for the, you know, the background of the ocean. And but the movie was supposed to take place off of Scotland. Then you had President Calvin Coolidge and Herbert Hoover, who was later president. They were there. The presidential yacht was the Mayflower, and they were in the harbor. Of course, Coolidge was former governor of Massachusetts, so he was no stranger to Marblehead and in Beverly area. I love this one, 1947. What I actually like the most about this picture is it was a baseball game that day. The pitcher and catcher stayed out there warming up. They kind of, you know, didn't seem to mind that there's a helicopter parked in center field with a crowd around it. And it was Lucille Ball who was coming to Marblehead. She did different plays, and they used to do the Marblehead Summer Theater. She was appearing on stage at that, so she came in by helicopter. That's Lester Marsh, who was a selectman at the time. And there's another shot of them coming off of the field. Lucille Ball, Lester Marsh, and Charlie Woodfin was the policeman. I remember when they used to have a couple of diamonds out in left field and right field. And I heard she wasn't really very friendly to the fans. Some people wouldn't watch the. This was before the I Love Lucy show was even on the air, because that didn't come on until the 1950s. Ironically, the same year, Vivian Vance, who was Ethel on the I Love Lucy show, was appearing in Marblehead. And I always wonder if it was the Marblehead connection where they originally met. Then in 1958, Home Before Dark was filmed. So this is down at the wharf. This is a real old shot down at the wharf. It's not dated, but I love this one. This is, you can see State Street. This is down. This area got filled in to make the parking lot bigger. The Driftwood is about over in here now. And that sign says Bayview Boat Club. And there's a fish market. And this one's not dated, but based on the way they're dressed, I mean, this is probably 1870 or maybe even sooner. And here's a shot from Old Burial Hill looking out towards the neck. Almost no trees at all on the neck and between the old burial. That's the old lighthouse out there, the old stone one. The new one was built in 1896. You can see some of the stones from Old Burial Hill. This is the one street coming up. That's another one down by Graves, down at the wharf area. This one was marked Hurricane 1938. I didn't really see any damage, so I'm not sure what this was, before the hurricane or after. Then this is that. This is the same area. You can see State Street, that liquor store that was on the corner where the art store is now, and a couple of, I guess, tugboats. Stearns and McKay was located down there. Now this one, it's got the machine shop showing, but somebody just posted on Facebook just a few days ago when they moved this building from Front Street out to on the water where it is now. They moved it across the street and turned it, and that still sits there today, down off the Graves property. And it's just a view from the looking back out to the harbor from where those boats were sitting. And 1954, frostbites. I don't really know my boats very well, so a lot of the pictures of the old boats, I can't really talk about the boats themselves too much, but I'm sure there's a lot of mariners here that
fire pots.
That know. This one I like, the telephone pole's kind of in the way, but this is looking down at the landing, the way it used to be before they filled it in. like the restaurants over here. Now there's that's the building that was moved over. And this is where the driftwood is, and it's the Harborview Dairy. It's the only photo I've come across when it was the dairy there before the, it was actually after that, it was the main brace, and then it was called the driftwood. That's 1938, down at Graves boat, down at the same part of the harbor. And 1941, that's the Queen Ferry. That's the float off of Crocker Park. In 1952, the Red Shoes, that was built by Floyd Soule, and this was the launch, and got a pretty good crowd down there to watch them put it in the water. And it's the Marblehead Transportation Company in 1958. I love the photos that have the old cars in it. I love the old cars, especially the 50s cars. And there's the Transportation Company, 1968. That's another shot before the landing area was filled in. You can see the driftwood there. And that was the bus for the YMCA day camp, 1964, down on Front Street. I guess they made the kids walk back there from the wharf. And that's John Pete Campbell working on his boat. He's been scraping it down to paint. This was in October, so he's taking it out of the water and was getting it ready for next year. Now the Rockmere, the end of the Rockmere Hotel, 1965, when they were getting ready to take it down. And that was when they took the building down and cleared it out. And then 1966, they started building the Glover Landing condos in there. I actually worked in a lot of those with my father. He did some of the carpet work in those when they were putting them up. But. And that's Captain Keating. I call him Marblehead's first paddle boarder because he'd stand up in his canoe when he was paddling out to his boat in the harbor. This was 1970. And 1971, one of the times, doesn't look like it's completely frozen over. I know my father talked about walking across the harbor on at least one occasion. That's Don Russell in 1958, fishing down at the harbor. This is Fred Vining, George Simmons, and Bill Kuzner on the right, 1958. And that's Dick Kuzner, 1958. He said he was probably working for Joe Walker at the time. I guess that's bait in the boat. That's Doug Knight, 1960. Looks like a neat old boat, the one next to it. And Collie Williams and Dave Bartlett, because we just lost Collie a couple of months ago. This was in 1968 at the ferry. And that was a Boston Harbor cruise boat come into the float to go out. I love the wooden barrels, the wooden lobster trap on top of it. The Queen, I think this was a fish version that the Queen did, the old Johnson motor. And the 1958 police boat. This is the Corinthian Yacht Club. This is from a glass negative, so it's a very clear image. The workers, I'm not sure what was going on there, that they were doing some kind of work down at the float. And I guess they were taking a lunch break, and I kind of zoomed in on this guy sitting here. And it looks like he must have been sick, because it looked like he brought a bottle of medicine with him that he was having with his lunch. Then we got the old Boston Yacht Club when they were getting ready to tear it down. It used to be located in behind the, kind of in behind where the driftwood is now, is where it was. And the Eastern Yacht Club in 1938. And another one from down by the water in 1960. There's a view across the harbor from in front of the Eastern. You can just barely make out the edge of the Rockmere Hotel over there. And snow removal, it's actually Eddie Martin, who was a contractor in town for years, because he had the contract to work with the snow removal, and they dumped it in the harbor. I guess they did it so the kids could jump in it. At least the kid in the middle looks like he's got boots on. The other ones don't. It's like, it looks like it's probably low tide, but they probably had some explaining to do when they got home. Then storm damage down by, this is Front Street, down by Fort Beach, Fort Sewell's up in there. You can see what a beating the storms took on the wall. That was 1972, I'm sure probably the wall and fence didn't look much better after this storm was gone either. Then this one, there was no date on this. It's obviously it was some kind of hurricane, and it must have been one that caught people by surprise because there's an awful lot of boats washed up. It's like a lot of damage. That's Riverhead Beach. It's quite a mess. Here we got some beautiful places. This is Philip Tucker down at Tucker's Wharf, which was named after his family. That's from a glass negative. That's a pretty old image, like the wooden barrel. That's Jack Sinclair on State Street. He was a street sweeper and went around town, swept up. He's got the barrel in the middle, the big wheels to push his cart around. That's, I think the King's Rook was in that building afterwards. It says Bakery Deli, Frost's name is on the sign. There's just some old salts up at Crocker Park. It's Judd Mason in the middle. I guess that's a Phillips on the right, 1948. It's Amy Lockerbie and Lizzie Coffin, 1948. That's Bowdy Crown and Shield, and they were up at Crocker Park. There was a chestnut tree, and they were gathering the chestnuts. They had the pile, and David Thistlewaite is the one that's with them. Tragically, David was killed in a car accident up on West Shore Drive, I don't know, 6 or 7 years after this photo was taken. And there's Fred Vining pitching pennies with his friends down at that's the corner of State Street and behind there, but that's what they would do for entertainment, take your pennies down there and everybody would pitch them. Whoever got closest to the wall would get to scoop up and keep all the pennies from that turn. This is at the Osborne's building. There was a barbershop next to it. It was Sullivan's barbershop. It was Skinny Sullivan. There was Tom Mulcahy, Charles Reynolds, Frank Dolliver. And this was right across the street from the train depot, which is where the National Grand Bank is now. So you can see they sold tickets for the train and in the barbershop as well. That's Huckle Sweet down in his shanty. He was a fisherman. It's Bill Penny down behind Penny's Market in 1961. Originally had Penny's Market, Louis's Market right next to it, and that's kind of where Crosby's is in the back now, but that was the location of the side-by-side grocery stores in town. And that's Ray Owen. I'm not sure, one of his kids maybe. This is 1971, because he was the last one to run Lichman's. The glass negatives I had were all by Fred Lichman. Ray's father, Fred Owen, worked for him. He ended up taking over the business later, and then Ray ran Richmond's after that. Here's Harry Wilkinson riding on the Kelpie in 1959. Most of the slides I have were taken by Harry Wilkinson. This is Madeline Brown, 1959, just painting a scene up at Crocker Park, and I often wonder if this painting is sitting on somebody's wall today. Now there's Harishoff, who's of course a boat designer, and he did small crafts as well. This was one of his creations. He'd take it out in the harbor and paddle it around, 1964. You can see the Rockmere Hotel in the background of this one. That was Alfred Smith, the milkman from Martin's Dairy. Timmy's over at the beach, kind of right in the parking lot. They had a nice little stand to get your hot dogs and drinks, the old bus. And the village driver, it's probably Ed Shin with their truck. And that's Alan Mace with the Osborne's grocery store delivery truck. And that's on Darling Street. And this is the Hammonds and Gordon store down at 111 Washington Street. And that's where the driftwood is now. It was the main brace at the time. And this is Fred Kuzner and Pete Campbell painting it. Campbell's truck's out front. And so still, I guess they carried that color theme all these years. The driftwood's still that color. I like the old Coca-Cola sign. And the bowling alley down on Sewell Street. Lumpy Lanes is what everybody called it. And that's where the offices for the National Grand Bank are back in there now. This was a car lot next to it. That's what the cars over there were. And this was around 1902. It was the offices Eustace and Brown up at Crocker Park. That's the uniforms they wore in those days. And this one I'm pretty sure is John Harris. It's down on Front Street. I could, from this negative, I could get the number. It was number 5 on his badge. And that's Ben Dolliver, who I think is Kip Dolliver's great-grandfather. And of course, Kip Dolliver was a policeman in town. And there's Joe Cuff. I guess the woman's Annie Lyons. This is up at Crocker Park, 1959. It's Engine 3, I think. And there's Norman Peanut Powers. He's taking a little break up at Crocker Park in 1964. He rode the motorcycle. He must have the motorcycle that day because he's got the boots on. But. And this was the selectman group in 1931, a couple of the town officials. At Howard Lillybridge was in the center there. You got Rufus Titus and John Adams and Dick Tutt are also in the photo. That was Bill Bragdon, who was town clerk for a number of years. And he had the advertising cards. I know if you tell people today that they had overseers of the poor in Marblehead, they wouldn't believe you, but they actually had a department to handle that, and these three guys were running for a position. Then Warren Perry was running for selectman. Warren couldn't make it tonight. I was going to rip him about it, but he's a great wealth of knowledge, too, about Marblehead history. Him and his wife, Barbara, Hazel, they're good friends of mine, and they're good people. That was the football team in 1932. That's the uniforms that they wore. They just had the leather helmets. And they played the games down at Seaside. This is down at Seaside Park. In the 1930 girls basketball team in front of the high school. Baseball team, 1917. And again, the way they dressed then, everybody, all the men had hats on in the crowd to go watch a baseball game. Oh, Betty. Betty Hunt and Fred Bauer up at, this was one of the encampment days up at Fort Sewell. She looks the same. I took this picture, I don't remember what year, it was probably 1990s. Actually, Betty was a huge help to me when I started doing the research. I'd take my daughters, who are all grown up now and have, kids, but I'd bring them up and they'd sit on the floor and she'd keep them amused and I'd dig through the records for looking for the family tree information and she'd let me look at the old pictures and I spent a lot of time when she was at the Lee Mansion. She does a great walking tour. And this Frank Osborne at the liquor store, which was on the kind of left-hand side when you walked in the grocery store because they were on the corner of School Street and Pleasant Street. I think the travel agency's in there now, but that's where Osmond's grocery store was for a number of years. And Mary Tutt, probably best known for her standing on the street corner with binoculars at the light over an ocean in Atlantic, and should write down lights. And I guess if anybody was speeding, if anybody went through the light, it should be that she had the binoculars around her neck and should write it. I mean, I don't know if they ever acted on any of it, but she was faithfully there, you know, trying to keep people in line. Then Doni, Clarence Doan, was kind of known for raising his bottle to different things, but this was when they were tearing down the train depot. You know, I think it was a couple of years after they stopped using it, but he was kind of toasting that. You can see Essex Street in the background. Doni was a true character around town. He was kind of homeless, lived different places, but he never bothered anybody. He was just a real colorful character, and he'd probably be surprised that we're still showing pictures and talking about him today. Then we got Link Hawks down, couldn't do a slideshow without Link. He was down posing for the photographer down at the wharf. That's the last picture. I just have to kind of change a couple of things to start the video. The last is a 12-minute video I put together. The first part of it, it's almost like three different videos I put together for one to show it here. The first one, Ed Cowden, who just moved out to Nevada, I think, a couple of weeks ago. A friend of mine, after my last presentation, says, "Oh, you got to do a Marblehead Forever for Danny Dixey to use one of his presentations." So Ed went into the studio and recorded Marblehead version for me, just for me to use. So the first part of it is the music by him, and then there's some time-lapse stuff that I had worked on and put together with some now and then. So just if I can hit the right buttons and do this smoothly, we'll be all set.
The men of old were heroes who fought by land and sea to preserve their homes from tyranny and shame, and enrolled among the bravest writ high in history stands old Marblehead, beloved and honored name. Then Marblehead forever, God bless the good old town, may she never shame her noble ancestry. She was first in revolution, was first in 61, and from whiskey bondage we will keep her free. The men of old were heroes, but they are in their graves, and 'tis ours, their sons, the battle now to fight. For our homes and altars tremble before the greed of knaves who assail the cause of God and home and right. Then Marblehead forever, God bless the good old town, may she never shame her noble ancestry. She was first in revolution, was first in 61, and from whiskey bondage we will keep her free. Then up and do your duty, too long ingloriously did we sleep while rum held undisputed sway. Now rally with your ballots and let his hireling see that when first we drove him out, he went to stay. Then Marblehead forever, God bless the good old town, may she never shame her noble ancestry. She was first in revolution, was first in 61, and from whiskey bondage we will keep her free. Then Marblehead forever, God bless the good old town, may she never shame her noble ancestry. She was first in revolution, was first in 61, and from whiskey bondage we will keep her free.